Okay, so actually, I'm gonna record this for everybody to hear who's not missing this. So, welcome to the True Fans Hangout. Talking about the workshops and webinars and True Fans Hangouts. For the collaboration, the way we're trying to go forward right now strongly is by building the community. For a little perspective, a lot of times in the history of this project, we've gone around with a super lean approach, doing the most you can with minimal resources. And right now, essentially since 2011, we have access to a lot of social capital, a lot of people who hear about our project and are willing to collaborate. So we want to tap that. We want to tap that energy from many, many different people, and we can. So as we go forward we started the OSE webinars for collaborative literacy, for people who want to be OSE ambassadors, people who want to start chapters of OSE, so we can all start pulling together as a larger team. And instead of doing the minimum, most lean approach, we're trying to go to the point where, for any team that we start now, we consider the whole collaboration architecture. Who are all the people that should be participating? We've identified about 12 to 18 people for any project that we should really have, and we can get it, but it's just a matter of saying, okay, we're going to stop before we take on any project, and we're going to say, we're going to build the resources, we're going to make sure that critical roles like the project manager, for example, I am a product owner. I use the stuff that we develop, like the micro houses, the tractors, the micro tractors, everything we use, we dog food it. So I'm the product owner, but the critical part, we have to have a separate project manager. So the problem has been a lot of times that I was at the center of a lot of different activities. What we want to do from now on is create a number of parallel working teams that don't need me, that I would see myself best as a person who interacts with the project managers or leaders of each team, and that way we can get to a much bigger parallel effort. So Patrick, for example, like yourself, whatever you're doing, I mean, the question would be, how do we create something together? What's the format that we can do this in? Can you join some of our existing teams? Do we have some projects in common that we can explore? How does it really work in this open boundary project, where really the concept is that the boundaries being open, we can invite people at any time, like people like subject matter experts, advisors. We can pretty much have open boundaries, that which is a great opportunity, but also a great challenge for the turnover. There's a lot of people coming in and out, so therefore the documentation is critical. That how do you get people on really fast? How to get people up to speed and all of that. But yeah, and that's why we started the webinars, to really start coordinating a uniform, well-recognized process that everyone can follow, so that there's a total cohesion to the project, that anybody coming in understands what's going on. They get a crash course, we train them a bit, and then we can move forward. And we're thinking that, based on all our experience to date, if you want to just go to the webinars page, Jonathan, if you want to paste that in the webinars page. But the webinars are there exactly to align the whole community to all that we're doing, so that we can work more effectively as a group. If you want to look at the first one, I identify all the milestones that we've reached. We've shown that certain things work. We've shown that we can actually generate revenue from some of the work that we do. But at the same time, we're not coming to the table saying, oh, we've got this entire thing already done. No, it's about, what we have provided is a seed, an idea, a powerful idea that people can gather around, but we're not going to do everything ourselves. It's about getting the whole community involved around that. So that's the clarity to have about the status of completion, because a lot of people come to us and like, okay, give me this, give me that, and they don't really understand that, okay, we've got some ideas, some prototypes, some things that actually work, that are pretty much product releases, but it's about people coming together to collaborate. So that's the webinars. We're thinking currently that, so you see a lot of the workshops, as you see on the internet there, we've got about five or six already up online, and there's a few more that we're actually getting. There's also the Jonathan, if you want to type in the workshops link there. OpenSourceEcology.org is our site. If you go to the workshops tab, you can click on all the workshops. But We found that the workshops are a way to, one, have people meet, and two, they're revenue generating opportunity, so that if we develop collaborative development processes, we can have the culmination in the form of a workshop, which would be a good thing, so that it all comes together in a material reality, as opposed to, you know, just us developing and then maybe people don't see what the final product looks like. So the workshop concept, basically starting from a whole development process where a clear milestone is the fact that we're hosting a workshop where we actually produce, we prototype, we teach, we meet the community, and go forward. So with that said, maybe I can ask you a little more, Patrick. So what would be your hopes like when you attend the workshops? What would you try to get out of them?
A lot of my hopes are of course, to learn nuts and bolts.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I want to learn the documentation side of things. I want to know how you guys collaborate. I really like where you guys are going for it.
Yeah.
And I also feel like I have a lot of, like, I don't know if empathy is the word, but I, like, have a lot of understanding because I'm kind of doing a micro version of the same thing.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of overwhelmed, and I'm like, you guys are sort of like, wow, I was blew my mind. You know, like, you guys and there's a couple other people or groups in the world that are doing a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, you know, where's all the linkage and all that? So I really want to focus on, like the wiki idea to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's really awesome, but I'm a little overwhelmed with how to, like, start at Wiki, right? So I want, mm-hmm. a lot of it's like first, okay, I was looking at the documentation package, and I'm like, much as I want to learn the tractor, like, I want to learn the documentation side of things as well, and I kind of want to, I'm trying to do it on my own, and I wouldn't mind a little bit of the mentorship as far as, like, the little tips and tricks, be like, oh, okay, do it like that, because I got tricked up on simple stuff, you know, but
yeah.
Sometimes it takes hours, and then I work full-time as well. So, and then on top of that, I'm trying to, like, condition myself to, like, learn the routines of, like, what should be the better life. You know, I have, like,
yeah.
a certain ethic. How do you develop an ethic? And, like, I like B.F. Skinner and Walden too, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and I'm having, you know, conditioning's off. You get conditioned whether you like it or not. So how do you develop a condition for myself and a routine? And then how do you work with others to develop that exponentially? So I really like the documentation and the human connection as well as the practical specifics, I guess.
Yeah.
But I'm really wanting to, like, it took me a while to join because, you know, I didn't want to just willy-nilly kind of jump in and just sort of have, like, amongst all the other things I'm juggling right now, I didn't want to jump in, but now I want to come in. Like, I took time off work for this meeting. I took time off work for last week's meeting, too, but it was no big deal. I enjoyed myself anyway, so.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I just definitely want to start getting more involved and learning the process that of the documentation. And I could be a leader. Like, I have some decent skill. I just finished the permaculture course. I've done some perma for the Jeff Lawton one, and I've done some perma blitzes. And, you know, I have a decent, I think I can offer a lot too, and I'm happy when I can help people out.
Mm-hmm.
So I also want to help out as much. And, like, I'm a licensed electrician.
Mm-hmm.
I have a decent, you know, I'm no engineer or anything, but I'm half decent with tools, and I'm, you know, I got my license, like, it's not like I got my full license and all that stuff, and I have a broad general knowledge, kind of a generalist, software.
Yeah.
But,
so you're an electrician for full-time? Is that your full-time job?
Yeah, I've been a shift electrician, I've done, like, you know, I've done a little bit of residential commercial, but right now, for 2 years, I've been at a pulp mill on shift, and it's pretty, I've been learning a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Just about machine, like working with millwrights constantly, and about just the processes of all sorts of different processes. And some, like, I mean, pulp needs to be done. I like industry, but, you know, like, I'm kind of mixed up in life because the ethics of the pulp mill for me, like, I don't want to be, I'd rather build a pyramid for free, like, for garlic, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I mean, I'm getting compensated and I'm learning a lot, but it's not, I don't see this as my career because I don't, I'm not offering that much to humans other than white bleached pulp. Like, the ethics are not that good, you know, from the environmental transparency and all that stuff. So it's.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm kind of in the mix, and I'm kind of looking for mentors right now, I guess, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sort of lost. I mean, I have good people in my life, but sometimes my ideas, it takes a while for people to understand what I'm getting at. And right now, I'm up in northern BC, and there's great people, but I feel like I'm like this major leader and every, you know, and I'm like, well, I'm kind of used to being, you know, I'm sort of not, I'm just trying to develop my leadership roles, but it's sort of nice to have the support of, well, you guys or whoever, like, you know, mm-hmm. the support of people who are more knowledgeable about stuff than I am, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely would recommend that you listen. So there's been 3 webinars so far, and if you go on a wiki, just send that link in. It's called...
I opened up the link. I have the link popped up.
Okay. Definitely listen to those, because they'll get you started on the collaborative literacy that we promote. And that's a big question that we're trying to answer. Now, would you see yourself... What would be your ideal state in terms of how you're developing this or collaborating with open source ecology? I mean, how much time do you have to commit to it? What would be something you can... Because we're trying to find people to take on more of a leadership track where we can... I mean, at best, it would be there's 50 machines plus there's different products, right? The machines are the enabling tools, but what we span is just about anything. So you talk about building a house, which everybody needs, building a car, building a workshop, an enterprise of some sort. The derivatives are infinite, so we're open to different efforts around the world that either work explicitly on the tools or any derivative enterprises that come from those tools. So we have a broad scope of interest and we can involve a lot of people. But with that said, I mean, what would you like to see yourself, and how many hours, or would you see yourself in a leadership position where you can perhaps take one aspect? Like, I mean, if you're familiar with, say, trees, you know, something like a sawmill or a design of a house or something like that, or some kind of a project group or whatever. Tell me more what you'd like to see yourself in.
So this is my plan right now is, so I own a home, mm-hmm. and I'm sort of finishing up the permaculture design. So a lot of it's going to be done this summer and next summer. And mm-hmm. then, like I said, I work full time.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm also, you know, I'm not like, basically I'm thinking of easing into it. In a year from now, I'm half thinking of just, you know, I have a couple places I'm renting out. I make a couple bucks here and there. And I'm trying to, my goal right now is to sort of, there's a couple things I'm working on about myself, like my approach and everything else. So right now, the answer to how much time to open source ecology right now is not a huge amount from now to the next year, although I want to start working more and more with it. Because mm-hmm. as my goals blend with the OSE's goals, it could be more and more. But for the next year, realistically, like, you know, 5-10 hours a week possibly. And then I want to be working on, and it's kind mm-hmm. of touch and go too. Like, but I know that I have a knee surgery I have to do. So one reason I don't really want to, you know, I got the benefits and all that stuff, I paid into it. And I have mm-hmm. to do a knee surgery. And I'm going to take advantage of the fact that I have benefits and I can get paid while I'm off. But when I get the knee surgery, I'll be off for 2 months. Not probably. I'll pretty much be off for 2 months. I'll be doing some physio and all that stuff. But I want to try to build my, sort of working on my approach to life. I got this way of categorizing things and I'm trying to, it's sort of like a what's the point. So I'm using like the 5, I got a Roy G. Biv sort of a spread. And I'm working on, and then the sort of like what senses are being used in the land, water, shelter, and I'm working on the combination of that. I can go on for a little bit. I'm sort of nervous about it right now because I could maybe present it to you a little bit more when I come down or something. But
are you,
I'm working on my approach to life, and I'm soon to be mm-hmm. ready to like leave the industry and be full time wherever. Like I'm looking at whooping places
mm-hmm.
and like collaborating, and like in about a year I'd like to become full time. Like if we click, I'd have to think of going down to Kansas and like woofing for you guys for a while until I get better and better and better, and to a point where I could actually build it, be part of bringing the economy up and just making more food and having more shelter and being like having like nice things like culinary expression, you know, like the prosperous like abundances in life.
Yeah.
It's not that, you know, it's possible to eat well and.
Yeah. Yeah, to have a good life. I mean, that's what everybody's after. People, various different people have different ideas of what that means, but we're focusing on the regenerative aspects, so we actually make the place, the world, a better place when we leave. Let's see. Are you?
To start off, it's a little
I was
going to
ask.
Start off, but I want to get more and more involved to the
yeah.
point of potential full time.
Yeah.
My goal.
Yeah,
I
definitely.
I see the possibility with careers in front of you guys. With you guys.
Yeah, yeah. The way we're looking at things is just to let you know how we see people getting involved. I think that starting with a workshop is excellent. So typically when somebody's new, there's various things they can do on a wiki or a remote collaboration. But like the next level is when people actually show up on site, whether probably a workshop is a great experience because you get an immersion, you get to meet us and meet other people. And the real goal is to see how we can scale. Like right now we're exploring the workshops as a way to generate revenue, because in the workshops we provide both education, training, and then we produce machines too, which we can sell. So there's revenue in them. And our goal would be to train people to run workshops like that. And one of our next steps is to generate a more of an immersion curriculum. So we've talked about something like a month or possibly a 3 month course. So right now we're offering pretty much weekend courses, these immersion workshops where you really get to see quite a bit. But we're also seeing that that's not enough to take it to the next level where people actually replicate that and take it on as their own. There's a lot of things, a lot of different skills. And we feel it's our role to provide much more of that training. So probably the next direction, maybe like probably by next year, we'll offer more of perhaps this 1 month immersion. We'll see how it plays out, but we're definitely considering that as a way that we can actually train people to then come out able to run workshops or to produce things, whether they're in like an independent contractor for us, whether they work independently for others or get involved more on a core team. But it's really about building relationships slowly and, you know, people clicking and so forth. The main consideration right now for our scaling is, I think it is that training, because while we have the plans online, I mean, only the hardcore, you know, the super ambitious people get to do that. A lot of people don't have the time. It's a matter of how easy it is to do the replication. And I think that by the immersion training program, we can say, okay, you're coming into that explicitly to be able to do this as a livelihood. You know, that's the next step. I would say in the long course evolution of all these ideas from back when I was at the PhD level and finished that, all alienated, but, you know, finished that, I started organizing things and organizing different sustainability events and up to hands-on workshops regarding sustainability. But at the end of the day, I noticed it's like, wow, we all love this, go out for our weekend warriorship there, but then we go back and to our regular job on Monday. And I thought, well, okay, well, it's got to end with a point where, you know, what energy are we creating in the world? What are we generating as far as our livelihoods, so that's the energy that the world, pretty much world lives on? Where's the economy coming from? And we want to generate those people that are doing the regenerative enterprise of all sorts. And that's why we're actually focusing in some of the workshops in particular. So the Miracle Orchard and the Aforest workshop, we're having a dedicated enterprise day. So for example, if you'd like to install a Miracle Orchard, here's an enterprise day that explores all the economics, including how do we collaboratively develop and help each other on startups. So as we develop this, I mean, one, it's the development side, but for example, with the Miracle Orchard, the permaculture orchard idea, that's one of our workshops. How do we help people? How do we facilitate startup, given that if you were to get a turnkey package by hiring somebody and buying all the trees and all that, it would cost you like $43,000. That's the actual amount per acre to install the Miracle Orchard, UPIC, CSA type of style thing. Well, then we talk about, okay, so now let's talk about how we start a nursery so we can get pretty much all our stock from seed or literally free, especially if we have a program, develop an assistance program where as we develop the Miracle Orchard or some enterprise like that, we have an agreement that the people who come into that can benefit from this collaborative effort, and we help each other by sharing things like the plant stock, so we can collaboratively develop the sourcing, the information, the designs, but also help each other when it comes to the capital aspects, like the natural capital, which is the plants or the tools. We're trying to really take the, just drop the barriers on what those costs involved in that are. So that's an example how we want to promote open enterprise. Then with a forest workshop, so Shubendu, the fellow who's going to run that, I'm going to co-instruct it with him. But basically, he's open sourcing his model for how you do afforestation and how that works as a real business. And he's actually a world leader in that. He's making that a successful career for planting these extremely diverse urban forests. So we can open source that, help people start that up. First of all, with a whole operations plan, but second also, once again, with the material stock. Where do you get all those plants for a plant out? Where do you get the machines for doing the plant out? So that's kind of how we operate. Jonathan, are you still there? Maybe we can. I wanted to actually discuss some of the key issues So Jonathan's our community manager, and we've been talking a lot about what is like the next. If we talk about the next main step for OSC, you know, what is that? And after looking where we are right now, I mean, we've got about 27 replications of machines worldwide. About 12 of them are brick presses, but we'd like to see that point where this stuff is going viral, that many, many more people are doing it, many more people are starting now to contribute back. And what's the number one block to it? So this year we've been discussing a lot the role of teams, how